गुड मॉर्निंग। सो टुडे मॉर्निंग वील हैव ए केस डिस्कशन ऑन कार्सिनोमा स्टमक। टू मी विल बी टुडे विल बी प्रोफेसर संजय देवबक्शी। ही इज अ कंसल्टेंट सर्जन एंड वेरी गुड एकेडमिशियन एंड डॉक्टर माइती इज ऑल्सो देयर। सो वील हैव इंटरेक्शन टुडे एंड द प्रेजेंटेशन विल बी बाई डॉक्टर चंद्रकांत मौर्या। ही इज थर्ड ईयर देयर एट एम आर बांगलोर हॉस्पिटल। सो वील हैव डिस्कशन ऑन कार्सिनोमा स्टमक। सो यू कैन स्टार्ट।
Good morning, sir. My dear friends, today I'm going to present a case on CS stomach.
Start.
Okay. Good morning, sir, my dear friends, and my dear colleagues. Today I am going to present a case on CS stomach. Amar Kumar Singh, a 65-year-old gentleman, Hindu by religion, from Katatalla Leather Complex, Kolkata, is a security guard by profession and belongs to poor socio-economic group, presented to surgery OPD with chief complaints of pain abdomen since 1 year and vomiting since 6 months. Now going to history of present illness. The patient was apparently well 1 year back. To begin with, he developed pain in the epigastric region. The pain was gradual in onset and dull aching and non-radiating in nature. Initially, the pain aggravated after food intake and relieved on taking medications. But later, pain was continuous and usually relieved after an episode of vomiting. The pain increased after taking a food. After taking food, he gives a history of vomiting one episode almost daily for last 6 months, which was non-projectile, non-bilious, and contained semi-digested food particle. He has a history of significant loss of weight. That is, within 6 months, he has lost approximately 10 kilograms and reduced appetite for 6 months. He has developed constipation for last 2 weeks and passes hard stools daily. There is decrease in the urine output. No history of fever, generalized itching, melena, or hematemesis. No history of systemic signs of metastasis. Past history. No history of hypertension, diabetes, or tuberculosis. There is no history of any surgery in the past. No history of any major illness in the past. Then the personal history. He is married and has 3 children. Wife and all the children are healthy. He takes a mixed diet and has a habit of smoking and alcohol. He has a normal sleep pattern. He belongs to a lower socioeconomic status. Family history. There is no history of any similar illness in the family. No history of any cancer in the family. His both the parents died out of natural cause. He has 2 brothers. Both are healthy. Treatment history. Has been taking oral rotavirin occasionally and tablet pantoprazole since 1 year after consulting a private clinic. From here, he was referred to SSKM surgery OPD for further management. Allergic history. There is no history of any drug allergy. Summary of the history. A 65-year-old gentleman presented with chief complaints of pain abdomen since 1 year, gradual in onset and vomiting for 6 months. Pain was felt in the epigastric region, which was dull aching in nature, aggravated after food intake and usually relieved after taking medications initially and later subsided only after vomiting. Vomiting was non-projectile, non-bilious, and contained semi-digested food particles. There is a history of reduced appetite and significant loss of weight in last 6 months. He has developed constipation since 2 weeks. And there is no history of fever or passage of black tarry stools. He is a known smoker and alcoholic. He has no other systemic symptoms.
Okay, Dr. Devakshi, we can have some discussion on the history presentation.
Dr. Chandrakant, what is your impression of this? I mean, you've taken a very good history. So your patient who's 65 years old had pain abdomen for 1 whole year, then history of vomiting for the last 6 months, isn't it? The pain was episodic to start off with, aggravated on food.
Yes, sir.
And in the last 6 months, was also relieved by vomiting, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So what is your impression? I mean, if you, given this sort of a history, what are you basically thinking about? What is your, because when you do a clinical examination, you have to have something at the back of your mind. So what do you think?
So there is something that is obstructing the passage from the stomach. That.
So you have a gastric outlet obstruction, basically.
There may be some gastric mass that is obstructing the passage.
So what do you think might be the cause of this? You know, you, I mean, what is your impression?
So first of all, the patient is elderly, he's 65 year old gentleman, right, and he belongs to a lower socioeconomic status.
Okay.
And he has having a history of smoking and alcohol, then it suggests something. There might be some malignancy, that malignant mass that may obstruct the passage.
Okay. Now he had a history of 1 year, you know, of pain. So, he's a smoker and he's prone to alcohol. Can you completely rule out a peptic ulcer as a cause of a gastric outlet obstruction?
Yes,
given that sort of a
chronic ulcer can be ruled out. There is no history of any. There is no previous history of any peptic ulcer disease as given by the patient, and there is no history of any hematemesis or melena.
Okay, but he did have a solid one year of pain, which was very significant because it was aggravated by food, isn't it?
Sure.
Okay. Professor Shah, do you want to ask?
Yeah. Yes, a few way he described the history, some observations. Go back to history of present illness. You are commenting that he developed pain. So don't say somebody has developed pain. Pain is what? Pain is a sensation. It's a experiencing pain. So don't say he has developed pain. He complained of pain. And the other restriction is all right. Then in a patient who has got gastric out of obstruction, if you take the history very clearly and properly, you will find that the vomiting does not come on suddenly. Patient who has got a gastric out of obstruction, you should ask some more symptoms, whether he has got any sensation of fullness after meals. Usually, patient having gastric out of obstruction has some sensation of fullness after meals. That means he feels full after a small meal, which he was earlier taking easily. And then when the vomiting started, in patient who has got outlet obstruction, the vomiting history is not same for 6 months. You will find a patient, that patient who has vomiting because of outlet obstruction, they will say that initially when the vomiting started, the vomiting used to occur towards the evening. He has taken a breakfast and then after lunch he was full and then he started vomiting. And then as the obstruction is progressing, patient may complain of vomiting after each feed. So try to go into the depth. Unless you ask, patient will not volunteer. So try to find out whether he has got sensation of fullness after meals and he has vomiting, how this vomiting is progressing for these 6 months. Then he has commented that he has developed constipation. Nobody develops constipation. Here, what do you think the cause for constipation is here? Is he having a malignancy in the colon?
Dehydration.
Yes, that is, you have to keep in mind, but we will not infer anything. We will not come to a conclusion of anything based on this simple symptom. So try to describe his bowel habit. What was his bowel habit before this episode of illness started 1 year back? How many times he was going to the toilet? So frequency of bowel movement. How was the consistency of the stool? Whether he was passing any episode of blood or mucus or any black tarry stool. So try to describe the bowel habit rather than saying he has developed constipation. So you can explain the constipation because he's vomiting for the last 6 months. He's dehydrated. He's bringing out all the food material he's taking. He has significant weight loss. You said there is no systemic signs of metastasis. In the history, don't say signs. When you talk of the metastatic symptom in the history, don't say no systemic signs of metastasis. You say there is no symptom suggestive of distant metastasis. What symptom you encountered in this patient to say this line that he has no symptoms of metastasis? Because these are things you have not given in the history present illness. In GI, you should have mentioned about history of jaundice, any abdominal distension. Patient who has got a suspected outer obstruction may have sensation of rolling mass in the abdomen going from left to right. And then other metastatic symptoms like what you have incurred.
There was any jaundice.
Jaundice is one. Gone. Then Then respiratory symptoms, chest pain, cough, hemoptysis, breathlessness. Then bony symptoms, recent onset, low backache, any aches and pain in the limbs, any swelling in the limbs. Then neural symptoms, headache, loss of consciousness, convulsion, any symptom of cranial palsy, weakness of any of the limbs. So you write one line, no symptoms, isolation metastasis. But be prepared that examiner might ask you what you have inquired to say that he has no symptom of metastasis. Okay. So these are things you should get rectified when you present. Because somebody develops pain is what? He cannot develop pain. Patient felt pain or patient experienced pain. That is the way you describe in a better sentence. Okay. I think rest he has covered well. Huh?
Yes. Yes.
Awesome. Examination.
So physical examination, starting with the general survey. I have examined the patient in a well-lit room after taking proper consent. The patient is conscious, alert, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. His height is 5.3 feet, and the weight is 46 kilograms. He is average weight and dehydrated. BMI is 17.9. His epoch performance status is 1. Pallor is noted. No icterus, no cyanosis, clubbing, pedal edema, generalized or supraclavicular lymphatic. Vitals, the pulse rate is 94 per minute, regular in the radial artery. Blood pressure is 100 by 70 millimeter of Hg in the right arm and supine posture. Temperature is 98.6 degree Fahrenheit, respiratory rate 14 per minute. Now coming to the local examination. Examination of the abdomen has been done in supine position with arms by the side and the exposure from mid-thigh to just above the GF sternum. Next. On inspection, the shape and the contour of the abdomen is scaphoid. Umbilicus is centrally placed and inverted. There is no visible peristalsis, no pulsations. The skin has got no scars, no pigmentation, no venous involvement. All the quadrants move equally with respiration. No visible swelling over the abdomen. Hernial orifices are normal and the external genitalia are normal. On palpation, superficial palpation, the temperature is normal. Tenderness in the epigastric region is present. There is no mass palpable. Deep palpation I could not do because the patient was complaining of pain. On percussion, resonant sound all over the abdomen. There is no free fluid. On auscultation, peristaltic, normal peristaltic bowel sounds are audible. No added sounds. Per rectal examination, the rectum was empty and no mass could be felt. On systemic examination, cardiovascular system, S1 and S2 were heard, no added heart sound were there. On CNS, no focal neurological deficit. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sound, and spine, no spinal tenderness is not. Summary of the case. A 65-year-old gentleman presented with history of pain abdomen, one year, which was gradual in onset, dull aching and no radiating to back. Initially relieved on medication and in latter period, pain usually subsided after an episode of vomiting. History of reduced appetite and significant loss of weight in the past 6 months. There is no history of fever, melena, hematemesis, and a history of constipation since 2 weeks, but normal bladder habit. On general survey, patient is malnourished, chronically dehydrated, and has pallor. No generalized or supraclavicular lymphadenopathy. On examination, tenderness is elicited in the epigastrium, but no muscles palpable. No free fluid in the abdomen. Normal peristaltic sounds are heard. Provisional diagnosis. Now, this is a case of gastric outlet obstruction of malignant origin, probably due to CS stomach.
Yeah. Dr. Chandrakant, can we go back to your first slide? You know, first signs.
Yeah, sir.
Sure. Right. Now, how did you find out what tells you that this patient is dehydrated? You said the patient is dehydrated. So what did you examine to define?
First, the patient gave history that there is a decreased urine output.
Okay.
Said that previously he used to pass urine.
Yes, that is in history, but this is examination, isn't it?
Yes, sir. On examination, sir, we can see the oral mucosa. Mm-hmm. You can see the mucosa that will be dry, comparatively dry. And we can see the skin turgor is lost. The skin elasticity is lost.
Okay. What else?
The patient will be thirsty.
Okay, that's a symptom. That's fine. But what in signs? Any changes in the temporal area? Any changes in the eye?
General appearance. If you look at the patient,
the luster will be lost.
Not luster. What can happen to the eyes?
Sunken eyes.
Sunken eyes, yes.
Sunken eyes, and? Yes. And?
The dryness in the conjunctiva.
Okay, there's some loss of fullness. There's a shrunken area in the supratemporal region also, isn't it? And sometimes even you might have brittle nails, and your the skin turgor, as you quite rightly said, is lost. So where did you see the skin for the skin fold thickness?
Skin fold thickness at the triceps.
Okay. You said that the ECOG's performance status is one. What in your clinical examination tells you that this is a cancer? I mean, aside from your history, when you do an ECOG performance status, you're actually opening yourself to the diagnosis that this has to be a cancer, isn't it?
Yeah.
If I were to tell you this is a peptic ulcer, which developed gradually, 1 year of history of pain, then which was aggravated on food. Patient is a smoker and an alcoholic. Sure. So the patient may well have a peptic ulcer causing a gastric outlet obstruction, isn't it?
Sure.
So the moment you say ECOG, you have to have something. For example, today, if you had a left supraclavicular lymph node, a hard left supraclavicular lymph node or a mass in the abdomen, then you could have done an ECOG, isn't it? At the present moment on your clinical examination, you really haven't found anything, isn't it, to justify a diagnosis of a cancer. So what is the other performance status that you could have used?
Karnofsky is good.
Okay. So according to Karnofsky, what would the performance status be?
Well, it would be 90.
Okay, so 90. Fair enough. You said that the patient has pallor. Where did you search for the pallor?
Pallor first in the nail beds. Mm-hmm. And after the inner side of the tongue and the soft palate.
Okay. Anywhere else?
Sir, I can be a lower palpebral conjunctiva.
Okay, now you have also said that this patient doesn't have icterus. Where do you search for icterus?
The eyes.
Which part?
Sir, upper bulbar conjunctiva.
Sclera.
Sclera.
Okay, where else?
After that, the generalized skin can be seen, the palms can be seen, the skin of the palm and sole.
Uh-huh.
And the soft palate can be seen.
Okay. Where else?
In the back of the tongue.
Back of the tongue. Is that the correct definition of where you search for an icterus?
Underside of the tongue.
Undersurface.
Undersurface of the tongue. Yes. Why the undersurface of the tongue? Why not the dorsum of the tongue?
It has the undersurface of the tongue has got more of fibrous tissue.
No.
What does the dorsum of the tongue have, which is different from the undersurface of the tongue?
It has got first the mucosa.
What does the tongue use to taste food?
Taste buds.
So if you look at your tongue, if you look at a patient's tongue, and they'll ask the patient to stick the tongue out. The surface of the tongue is what? Is it plain normally?
Sir?
Is it plain?
Dorsum of the tongue. Is it dorsum plain or do you find something in the dorsum?
No, sir. It has got multiple papillae.
Papillae, yes. And in addition, so it doesn't take stains very easily, isn't it? The ecterus is more prominent than the undersurface. Besides that, in our country, we tend to eat a lot of haldi, you know.
Sir, that can stain the dorsum of the tongue.
And that can stain the dorsum of the tongue. Okay. Sir. Okay, you search for clubbing. Can you tell me the stages of clubbing? What are the stages of clubbing?
Sorry, sir.
Do you know the stages of clubbing? Stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, and stage 4?
What is clubbing? Just define. What do you mean by clubbing? What is clubbing?
Clubbing is...
increased curvature of the nail. Both anterior and the transverse. So what happens? What happens in that is the stages. Yes.
Grade 1 parrot beak, grade 2 dumbo, grade 3 obliteration of the lingual dumbo, grade 4 hypertrophy of osteoarthritis.
Yes.
Yes. So absolutely right.
So these are the stages. The basic definition is there is increased curvature of the
nail.
So when this starts coming up, then there is an angle in the skin fold and the nail bed. When this starts, this progresses and the terminal phalanx become wider. And in the stage 4, there may be a serious change in the wrist. So there are different stages. So it's not that we will not be asked about the general survey. Keep in mind that you can ask anything in the whole presentation.
Okay. There's an angle that, as Dr. Shah said, there's an angle. And there's a sign, eponymous sign, that goes with that angle. Shamrod when you hold sign. Up the...
Yes.
Sorry?
Shamrod sign.
Shamrod sign. Yes, absolutely right. So now you have also assessed for supraclavicular lymphadenopathy, right or left?
Left supraclavicular lymphadenopathy.
Why is the left supraclavicular lymphadenopathy more importance to you? Why not the right?
The thoracic duct... the metastasis can happen to left supraclavicular lymphomas.
Okay. Because of the thoracic duct. How can you trace the path from the stomach to the left supraclavicular lymph node?
Using a indocyanine ring?
No, just define the anatomy. Describe the anatomy of this. You have, let's say, a stomach cancer at the antrum, as you are trying to establish. And from there, they spread to the left supraclavicular lymph node. Now, what is the route? What is the pathway?
It starts from small intestine, cisterna chyli.
Okay.
In the right side. And till... thoracic vertebra T5. At T5, it crosses towards the left.
T4 actually. Okay, yes, fine. I'll grant you that.
Descends upwards and drains into the angle between the brachiocephalic and subclavian plane.
So why does the supraclavicular lymph node, does that lymph node have a name?
Yes, a Virchow's lymph.
Virchow's lymph node. Okay, now if I were to ask you what node station in the neck is it? What is the node station for the left Virchow's lymph node? What is the node station?
Station of level of lymph. What does it call? Sure.
First, tell me where is the lymph node palpated?
Left supraclavicular fossa.
No. Exactly where it is. In between the two head of?
Sternocleidomastoid.
So if you go by that, it is not exactly posterior triangle. It is in the line of jugular vein. So where it is? which lymph node station should be?
Which lymph node station?
Four.
Yes.
Should be?
So it's
level four. It's not level five.
It is not level five.
Supraclavicular is level five. Supraclavicular lateral to the posterior sternocleidomastoid is level five. But this Barkov's node is level four node, which lies between the two head of sternocleidomastoid. It's a level four node.
Okay. So,
and again, you have to keep in mind that this is not a direct spread from the thoracic duct. When the thoracic duct carries the cancer cells, this thoracic duct may get blocked because of this cancer cell deposition. And this retrograde spread via the thoracic into the Barkov's node. It's a retrograde spread to the Barkov's node.
So, as Professor Saha said quite rightly, it's a retrograde spread to the lymph node. Can it spread to any other node?
Sir, left axillary lymph node?
Which axillary, which group? It's the anterior group, isn't it? Does it have an eponymous name as well? The anterior left anterior axillary lymph node is sometimes enlarged in metastases where you also have, on the same rationale as Professor Shah said, it's a retrograde spread to the Virchow's lymph node. So that has a name, a Virchow's lymph node. Do you have any other name for this particular lymph node, the anterior axillary lymph node?
The Irish nodules.
Yes, it's called the Irish nodule. So why does it happen on the left? Let's suppose you have the similar thing on the right, supposedly. Can you have a right? It is classic description. It's a left anterior axillary lymph node is the Irish node.
Okay.
So why the left? Can a similar thing happen on the right?
Sorry, sir.
See, the lymph nodes of the arm and the axilla driven by something called the subclavian trunk. On the right side, it drains independently into the junction between into the vein. On the left side, it joins the thoracic duct. So just like Professor Shah quite rightly told you, it's a retrograde spread to the Virchow's lymph node. You have a retrograde spread to the left anterior axillary node, not... You can't have a similar spread on the right side. So what important nerve lies behind the Virchow's lymph node? I mean, if you have a very large node, the patient sometimes complains of a problem because of a very important nerve that lies behind the lymph node.
What nerve?
Suppose the patient were to come in with shortness of breath.
There is a muscle behind and the nerve crosses in front of that muscle.
Thoracic nerve or bell?
No. It's in the neck.
It's a neck.
We have scalenus anticus muscle behind the lower end of sternocleidomastoid. What nerve runs on the anterior surface of scalenus anticus muscle?
So that's a very important nerve that lies on the scalenus anterior.
That is...
It comes from 3-4-5, cervical 3-4-5.
Phrenic nerve, yes.
Left phrenic nerve. So you can have a unilateral diaphragmatic palsy. Okay.
Sure.
Right. Let's go to the next one. Next slide. I think this is all right, Professor Shah. Can we move to the next slide?
He said patient is malnourished. So how did you do a... nutritional assessment in a patient?
Yes.
What are the components?
For nutritional assessment, we see the first the skin fold thickness.
First, in general appearance. You see, patient, he said he has got a BMI of 17.9. He look emaciated. So, general look. The patient will have emaciation, wasting of the muscle in the face, malar prominence. We look at the limbs, so he will look emaciated. General appearance. Next is, you see the muscle bulk. That means you go to the medium circumference, which will indicate the protein deficiency or the muscle bulk in the body. then assess the skinful thickness. Apart from this, you assess patient will have micronutrient deficiency. So patient may have night blindness. Patient may have bitter spot in the sclera. Patient may have glossitis. Patient may have chelitis. Patient angular stomatitis. So you should also look for the micronutrient deficiency. And finally, the objective assessment is by BMI. You calculate that. You see, in general survey, you need not speak about height and weight. You can just straight away go for BMI. Once you say BMI, that means you have gone through this body weight and height. So you need not mention separately the height and weight. You just say BMI. So that is the assessment for nutritional assessment. Okay? Okay. Next. Chalo. In abdominal examination, you have missed out something. You see, patient who has got a features of outer obstruction, apart from the routine abdominal examination, you should examine for number one, succussion splash and auscultopercussion. It's good.
Yes.
It's good that you have said, I have not done the deep palpation as the patient was having pain. So in the exam, don't make the patient cry. You can avoid saying this, but keep in mind that you are looking at a patient who is not that having pain. So you should also try to cover the points you should be mentioning in deep palpation. Okay, what are the points you mentioned in deep palpation for abdominal examination patient?
First, there is
a... Next slide, Dr. Chandrakar. Next slide.
Next. Yeah. So this is fair enough. If the patient is so much of pain and then his tenderness, don't try to go into deep palpation so that he starts crying in the exam and he'll fail.
But Dr. Shah, should he have also looked for epigastric fullness?
Yeah.
On inspection.
Yes.
And perhaps a peristaltic wave.
Yes.
Which goes from left to right. And it's sometimes called a cannonball peristalsis. Why? Because it looks like the old cannonballs. Isn't it?
Any epigastric mass, the peristalsis will increase and it will start from left hypogastrium. Then epigastrium,
left hypochondrium,
epigastrium, then umbilicus, then right hypochondrium.
Yeah. So how do you, and as quite rightly Professor Shah said, how do you do an auscultopercussion? How do you hear the succussion splash?
Succussion splash, the patient lies in the supine position and the bell of the stethoscope is kept at the epigastrium.
Is there anything you would like to tell the patient to do? Find out from the patient before you do a succussion splash.
Yeah, the patient should not have taken any fluid for last 3 hours, at least 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah. So yeah. If you take in a meal, then it will be even a normal person, you can have succussion splash. Yeah. And then how to do auscultopercussion? Why do you do auscultopercussion? Why do you do it?
Auscultopercussion is to find out the greater curvature of the stomach, the boundary of the greater curvature of the stomach.
That means you outline the stomach.
Delineate the...
Okay, normally, where is the beta curvature running in a normal person? If you do a normal person, why do you find that the curvature is running in its umbilicus? Usually it is above the umbilicus. Okay, except in very thin and lean individual where it may be J-shaped stomach, where it can go below the umbilicus. But in a usual person, you say above the umbilicus. Patient having outer obstruction, it can go jolly well below the umbilicus. So then it's called the percussion. Fine, rest of the examination is all right. And in while doing rectal examination, you see no mass felt. What mass you are expecting in a patient who has got a suspected carcinoma stomach? What mass you are expecting? Is it intrinsic rectal mass or looking at something else?
Something else.
Where?
Peritoneal metastasis in the rectovesicle.
What is that called as?
Rectovesicle. Bloomer cell.
Bloomer cell. So you look at the anterorectal wall, where there is a shelf-like projection into the anterorectal wall. So you can say that there is no mass, means no bloomer shelf felt.
Right. Okay.
So you can pass on to next part. He has to justify the diagnosis.
You have to justify a diagnosis of a cancer. Because if I tell you this patient, it seems to me this patient has a peptic ulcer causing a gastric outlet obstruction. So how would you justify your diagnosis? That
any point in history to suspect this patient may have malignancy?
So, from the history, we can see that the patient is elderly male, belonging to lower socioeconomic status.
Even gastroesophageal stomach is not a disease of low socioeconomic. So it can happen in affluent society also. That is not a specific point in favor diagnosis of CS stomach. One is elderly gentleman. Second is versus 1 year is not a very long period of peptic ulcer short disease, short duration. And he has no past history of peptic ulcer disease. And one more important thing is patient with outer obstruction with benign disease may have weight loss, but appetite will be preserved. This patient has got a progressive loss of appetite, which is a very important symptom in favor diagnosis of carcinoma stomach in this patient. So pick up that point.
Yes, particularly loss of appetite to animal proteins also.
So that is an important point in contrast to peptic ulcer disease. Patient may have pain, patient may have vomiting, but once he vomits, he is feel hungry. Patient is peptic ulcer, but he has got this weight loss will be there in both.
There it is.
Okay. So this patient has got outer obstruction and we are saying CS stomach. What may be the differential diagnosis apart from CS stomach is one possible degree.
The first probable diagnosis, provisional diagnosis, alternate diagnosis can be chronic duodenal ulcer and can be enlarged tuberculous lymph node that can compress external compression or some. There can be periampullary carcinoma.
Does periampullary carcinoma that's cause early obstruction or something else in the pancreas cause outer obstruction?
Not early.
Carcinoma head of the pancreas. Head of the pancreas more commonly causes outer obstruction than a periampullary lesion.
Yes.
What else?
But there may be obstruction, features of gastric outlet obstruction due to trichobezers or phytobezers.
Before that, try to think of more commoner, because you say malignant disease, say. So there are some of the malignancy which can have similar presentation.
Gastric lymphoma.
Yes. What else? Any other tumorous lesion in the stomach which can cause outer obstruction?
GIST, gastrointestinal
stromal. That should be a
problem. Yes. There's also another structure that lies on top of the duodenum.
You said patient has got increasing constipation. So if he has definite alteration of bowel habit, he has some GI symptoms in the form of bleeding, mucus in stool, it may be a colon, which is causing extending compression in the gastric outlet area. So don't put a very wild diagnosis in DD. Bezoar is a theoretical possibility, agreed. But this is a gentleman, elderly gentleman, is not having psychotic symptoms. So bezoar will be a remote possibility. Okay. So Dr. Boshi, you can pass on to the next part.
Okay, yes. So given this sort of a thing, what are you going to do about this patient? Patient has been vomiting for 6 months. Has come to you dehydrated with loss of weight, and you're thinking in terms of a carcinoma of the stomach, which is causing a nodule. That's your first differential, isn't it?
Yes.
So, what are you, how are you going to proceed after this?
I would like to do some investigations to support my diagnosis and to confirm my diagnosis and to stage the disease. And to plan further line of management and prepare the patient for anesthesia.
Okay, so as I see it, your patient has few features. He has dehydration, has loss of weight, has come in even constipated, and he has a gastric outlet obstruction by, you know, because you have non-bilious vomiting. So now how are you going to proceed? What investigations are you going to do?
Blood
in sequence. Yeah, okay. What blood investigation?
Why do you start basic biology in this patient? You make a heading that you do investigation to confirm your diagnosis. Why do you start basic blood investigation? How hemogram is going to help at this stage? So keep stick to your outline of presentation. You said you do investigation to confirm the diagnosis. Investigation to stage the disease. investigation to assess his fitness for incision surgery and the preparation. So start with that.
The investigation started.
You see, you keep in mind always, ultrasound is a bedside examination. And ultrasound is an extension of your clinical examination. So it's no harm in any case, in any abdominal case, you say, sir, I'll do an ultrasonography as extension of my clinical examination. Because you'll find people, the AIIMS boys presenting a case, they will say the ultrasound finding also. Because they are allowed to do ultrasound on the bedside for all their patients. So in the presentation, they will say, I have done ultrasound in the patient. So that is the extension of clinical examination. That is not counted as a very serious investigation that has to be done by always a radiologist. So ultrasound is an extension of clinical examination. But patient has got a GI mass. Ultrasound is not a very good investigation to assess the mass by ultrasound examination. So you can say that. But start with the confirmation of diagnosis. What? So
start with a flexible endoscopy. And after that, we'll take, if there is mass, we will take some biopsy.
Where will you take the biopsy from? Let's suppose you have not a mass, but you have an ulcer. Okay, I'll grant you a mass. So where will you take the biopsy from?
The biopsy has to be taken from all the four quadrants and plus from the center.
Yeah. So it should be 8 to 10 bits of biopsy. You take biopsy, it's two bits from each of the quadrants.
Of the quadrant and one from the center, two from the center.
So it should be 8 to 10 bits of biopsy.
There's also a rationale for also resuscitating the patient also, isn't it? You've taken confirmed the diagnosis, but the patient has come in with gastric outlet obstruction. So let's suppose after this, you're waiting for the biopsy to come back. That's going to take 4 to 7 days. What else would you now do?
The initial resuscitation of the patient has to be done first.
How are we going to resuscitate this patient who has got all features of dehydration? Features of malnourishment.
Intravenous fluid. We'll start with intravenous fluid.
So, what is your anticipation of the electrolytes? I mean, can you tell me what is the likely scenario?
The metabolic changes that can happen.
What are the changes he has? Number one, he has got dehydration. Number two,
second, metabolic alkalosis.
And electrolytes.
Electrolytes.
Decreased chloride level.
Yes.
Okay.
What this should be very spontaneous. Why should you start thinking about it? Is hyponatremic, hypokalemic, hyperchloremic, metabolic alkalosis? So, because in a full blown picture, all the electrolytes got deficient. So, itna sochne ke baad kya hai?
What happens to the albumin? This patient is 17.3 BMI.
Serum albumin level will go down. It will be decreased.
It will be decreased. And it's unusual because despite the low albumin, the patient doesn't have edema, isn't it?
So
why does this patient have hypokalemia?
Hypokalemia. How do you explain hypokalemia in a patient who is having an outlet obstruction?
I mean, if you look at a mixed gastric aspirate, what is the content of sodium, chloride, and potassium in a mixed gastric aspirate?
So, then
sodium is what milliequivalents per liter?
Sir.
Okay, I'll grant you it's about 100. Chloride is about 120. What is the potassium?
Potassium is about 20 millimol per liter. Okay.
So, which means what now you explain why this patient has hypokalemia.
Sir, due to this persistent vomiting, there is loss of acid, that is hydrogen ion and chloride ion. Mm-hmm. If there is persistent loss, then the body, the kidney tries to excrete more of bicarbonate to compensate with this alkalosis. With this bicarbonate, some sodium is also lost along with it.
Yes.
Once the sodium is lost, there is a loss of water along with sodium. So there will be dehydration. The RAS system is activated and it tries to preserve the sodium. When preserving the sodium, what happens, it tries to, it, along with sodium, when it reabsorb sodium, there is loss of hydrogen and potassium ions. Yeah. That leads to paradoxical aciduria.
And also hypokalemia. Hypokalemia is number one. The question asked is hypokalemia is because of loss of potassium in the vomitus itself, plus towards the later part of compensation to conserve sodium in the distal tubule, the body loses hydrogen and potassium. So the potassium is loss is aggravated. Vomiting plus the loss in the distal tubule because of aldosterone response. So how are we going to correct this metabolic abnormality?
How are you going to correct that?
First, IV fluid has to be given, proper IV fluid, normal saline. And once the urine output is restored or it is adequate, then we can add potassium chloride, KCl injection into the saline infusion. Okay. And after that, second thing is for hypoalbuminemia.
Okay. How will you assess that patient is adequately hydrated? Once you start the saline, how do you assess yes, patient is now adequately hydrated?
First, the vitals, you can see the vitals.
Before that, you talk of thirst, patient was thirsty. Thirst. What will happen to that?
The thirst will decrease.
He will not feel thirsty because he's hydrated. What else?
The urine output.
Before that, he said his eyes are sunken. He said his oral cavity, mucous membrane was dry.
Right.
So the dryness should go off. You see, skin turgor was reduced. Skin turgor should be normal now. And then urine output is an objective assessment. If you have put the catheter or you start measuring the urine output hourly, what should be the optimal urine output you are happy? What is the optimal urine output you are happy?
1 ml per kg per hour.
Good. So that indicates that patient is adequately hydrated. So you should assess also how much fluid you should give. And at what point you say that patient is adequately hydrated? Albumin is less. How do you address that issue?
Since the patient is the albumin is low, oral high protein diet should, can be given.
Patient has gastric outlet obstruction. You didn't say whether the endoscopist could go into the duodenum or not. You found a mass, you said. If the endoscopist says I could not proceed into the duodenum, the pylorus is completely blocked.
So oral is difficult to manage. But one caution is keep in mind that the answer in the exam is not I'll give the patient albumin transfusion.
Yes.
Albumin deficit means is a marker of global malnutrition.
Malnutrition.
So it is not to be addressed by giving albumin transfusion. In this patient, the answer should be I should give the patient nutrition. If he can tolerate orally, I start giving oral. Or if I made some other route for enteral feeding in the form of feeding agents to give through that, or I should give the TPN. The answer is not albumin transfusion. Answer should be give the patient total parenteral nutrition because albumin deficit is a marker of global malnutrition.
Malnutrition. Right. So you have 7 days. Now you have addressed, as Professor Shah said, the hypoalbuminemia. Please do not give the patient albumin. It doesn't work. It comes out in urine. It's a very expensive way of getting urine to produce albumin. So don't give albumin. As he quite rightly said, nutrition, if there's any chance that the endoscopist possibly saw a small opening, you might even ask the endoscopist to put in a feeding tube and feed the patient, because preferably enteral, as he quite rightly said. If not, then you might even need to, if in a serious condition, you might even need to establish a feeding jejunostomy, isn't it? And worst comes scenario, you will go in for a total parenteral nutrition. Now, if the patient is on total parenteral nutrition, how would you assess this patient? What are the tests you would do to assess this patient? So we do some tests, isn't it? You need to do almost once or alternate days the sodium and potassium group. Don't forget you're correcting that, and chloride, because there's hypochloremia as well. you would also do at least once a week, you would do a liver function test. Why would you do a liver function test once a week?
To see the
total parenteral nutrition.
The level of albumin. Okay. That we are commenting whether it has...
Anything else other than that? There's something called a refeeding syndrome. What is a refeeding syndrome?
Refeeding syndrome, that is a consequence of, mostly a consequence of total parenteral nutrition. It occurs when the patient is in a chronic starvation or he has not been given proper, he has not risen starvation, and suddenly if he is given a diet or a high calorie diet containing more of carbohydrates and all, then the patient develops some features like tachycardia and dizziness.
So what do you need to do to ensure that the patient doesn't have a refeeding syndrome? The
patient should not be given a large amount of feeds at once. Gradually the feeds should be started gradually, and low calorie diets should be given.
So what are the main trace elements that have been talked about as a culprit for causing the refeeding syndrome?
So phosphate
and magnesium, isn't it? Okay, we come back to your patient. You're waiting for the biopsy. 7 days later, your pathologist says, I don't know. I'm not convinced. Now what do you do?
Inconclusive biopsy report.
Inconclusive biopsy report.
We'll go for some further investigations.
What further investigations?
CCT of the abdomen.
How will that prove to you that this is a carcinoma of the stomach?
We'll do other investigations, but if the histology is inconclusive, how are we going to address that issue? Simple. Always do it. You have to repeat the endoscopy.
You have to repeat the endoscopy.
And take a re-biopsy.
Okay.
So in the meantime, you do the other investigations. How CCT scan is going to help in this patient?
So it helps in loco-regional staging or
yes.
Locally
how?
Spread.
How?
Assessment of a spread of disease in the adjacent structures, the lymph nodes, and
intraabdominal distant metastasis.
Yes, intraabdominal metastasis.
So it can help you T staging. Because T staging in GI malignancy is the depth of invasion in the walls of the stomach. Second is lymph node status. Third is liver, pelvic deposits, large omentanal deposits or peritoneal deposits. That can be picked up by CT scan. Which lesions are usually not picked up by a good quality CT scan?
Less than 5 millimeter.
What? 5 millimeter?
Lesions less than 5 millimeter.
In the liver?
Liver.
Or small peritoneal nodules.
Peritoneal nodules, yes.
Small omentanal nodules.
How does a cancer of the stomach spread, Dr. Chandrakant?
Various ways of spreading of a CS stomach. First, there can be direct spread.
Yes.
That is peritoneal, transperitoneal. There can be lymphatic spreads to the nodes, to the various lymph nodes. And hematogenous spread, most commonly, to the liver, lungs, and brain.
Okay.
Any other mode of spread?
Any other mode of spread?
There are three broad spread you describe in all situations. But stomach has claimed to have some other ways of spread.
Transilomic
spread.
Transilomic.
Anything else? How it can cause a umbilical nodule? What is that? Is it retrograde?
Retrograde lymphatic spread. And what is that nodule called? Umbilical nodule. Okay, right. Suppose you have a spread to the pelvis and this patient is a young female, comes in with large ovarian tumors. What is that particular type of tumor called?
Hukenberg tumor.
Can it happen in an elderly patient, elderly lady?
Can Hukenberg tumor occur in an elderly lady?
No, sir. Probably no.
Why not? Why not?
The older patient will have atrophy of the ovary.
Yes, so the blood supply isn't good enough to sustain a spread. And what type of tumors, traditionally, what was the description of a Krukenberg's tumor? What type of tumor originally was described as causing a Krukenberg tumor? Mucin-producing signet ring cells were the one, because they have less of E. cadherin, which prevents cells from sticking to each other. So that is how the whole concept of a transcelomic spread started, didn't it? Right. Now, what is a well biopsy?
Well.
What is a well biopsy? For a CA stomach, it is very important, particularly for infiltrative variants of a CA stomach.
Sorry, sir.
I would let Dr. Shah answer that, because I picked this up from his book. Dr. Shah, you might want to say what a well biopsy is.
Well biopsy, I'm not aware actually. But because
well biopsy, you take a biopsy from a same place, keep on taking it so that you go deep into the submucosa, particularly for an infiltrative variant of a...
Because in infiltrative, you can take a mucosal biopsy, it may not be conclusive. In that case, you take a more deeper biopsy.
Okay, so now, because we are running very short of time, Professor Shah, shall I ask for, let's suppose, the treatment?
Yeah.
The treatment. How would you treat this patient? Now, the report has come back as an adenocarcinoma.
You've done a CT. Any other investigation like to do?
Any, yes.
For diagnostic lab.
Before that?
Sir, PET.
PET is routine for CA? No. More than 50% of CA stomach are not PET avid. So, PET CT is not a primary workup for patient with CA stomach. Do you like to do a CT of the chest?
CT of the chest and pelvis.
That is a part of workup recommended. Oh,
absolutely.
Okay. So, CCT chest is a, it's not chest X-ray for chest metastasis. And don't say PET CT as primary workup for CA stomach, because most are not PET avid. You can do a serum marker like CEA, which is not a diagnostic investigation, but that can help in your assessing. So, if you now talk of the next treatment of this patient, apart from this, once you get the staging, then what in staging will dictate you to plan? That means, how is the CT scan going to help you in planning further treatment?
First, the site of the lesion, the size of the lesion, the loco-regional spread, the distant spread.
So, if you have,
Professor Shah said that it is very important to assess the T stage. That is why we do a CT scan, isn't it? He said that. So, how will that help you? Let's suppose you have a bulky T3, T4 infiltrative.
What I mean to say, do you think the treatment planning for carcinoma stoma will be same for a early disease, for a advanced disease, or a systemic metastatic disease? They are different. Okay.
Yes.
So hardly you find very early disease. These are more of screen detected gastric cancers. So question of doing a EMR does not come up in a patient who has got outer obstruction. So if you have a T staging done and you find the T is T3 plus or T4, there is gross lymphadenopathy. In that case, what may be the recommended strategy now?
In that case, I will plan for a exploratory laparotomy.
No, I given a scenario. Is the advanced disease on CT scan itself? The strategy now is not going for exploration. Now it's very clear in CS stomach. It's now neoadjuvant therapy. Because this patient has got a locally advanced disease in the form of T4 tumor, gross lymphadenopathy. So there is a role for giving neoadjuvant therapy. Even if I say now, the CT scan was not showing a T4 disease. It was maybe T2 disease and very few lymph nodes. In that case also, there is a role for doing staging laparoscopy.
Yes.
Because now on staging laparoscopy, we'll find that this tumor has gone up to the serosa. Upfront surgery is not recommended. So there is a role for doing diagnostic laparoscopy when you have a disease which is diagnosed in CT scan as early disease. But still there is a role for doing a
diagnostic laparoscopy.
But CT shows locally advanced disease. The recommendation is neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
What drugs would you use for a neoadjuvant?
Recommended regimen for CS stomach?
Sir, rifampicin, 5-fluorouracil and cisplatin.
Yeah, these are okay. standard drug for CS stomach.
Yeah, fair enough. There's also another new regime coming in called the FLOT treatment, because the trial is coming in being rapidly done because of its advantage. You use 5-FU, docetaxel, oxaliplatin and leucovorin. So that's called the FLOT therapy. So remember that the accepted is epirubicin, cisplatin and 5-FU. FLOT is coming in a big way. Okay, how many cycles?
Total
new adjuvant.
Yeah.
And then you reassess.
Usually 3 cycles. Three cycles review. And you find that it's a downstage patient is now going to a resectable phase. You can do the surgery and then continue the remaining cycles afterwards. Okay.
So what sort of surgery would you do?
It's an operable situation.
Operable.
You have done a diagnostic laparoscopy. It is not advanced disease. And you are planning to have a curative resection. What is the optimal surgery for cure of gastric cancer, which is a distal gastric cancer? Total gastrectomy for a distal gastric cancer.
So distal.
This is a patient who has got an outer obstruction.
Distal subtotal gastrectomy.
How do you say that?
What is the term that you use?
This is simple D2 gastrectomy. Why do you say subtotal? That depends on the extent of the lesion. If on exploration find there is a mass in the antrum, it will only be a subtotal gastrectomy. If it is a large tumor, then what is the extent of resection? Suppose you have explored and you find there is a distal gastric cancer. How do you decide about the proximal line of resection? Distal line of resection.
Will be
cardia. Cardia for a distal gastric cancer. Why cardia? You see, proximally there is spread for about 5 centimeters. So a safe limit for proximal is 6 centimeters. And distally, pylorus is a barrier. Pylorus is a barrier for spread of CS stomach to the duodenum. So it is good enough that you can go 2 centimeters beyond the pylorus. That means you take the first part of duodenum.
Yes.
First 1-2 centimeters of the duodenum. That is the distal line. What else? If I say it's a D2 gastrectomy, what are the other structures you remove with this stomach specimen?
What else would you remove?
Before that?
Momentum.
Which momentum?
Greater momentum.
From where to where?
From where to where?
You remove both omenta. If you say lesser omentum, where does the lesser omentum starts? It starts in the? It's a gastrohepatic omentum.
Gastrohepatic omentum is the lesser.
So it starts in the liver. It starts in the liver. Close to the liver, you start taking down the lesser omentum. Where in the greater omentum, you start in the? Not greater curvature. You start in the colon. You take dividing the gutamentum from the transverse colon. And while lifting this, what else you take with this?
Sir, superficial layer of the...
Not so. Superior layer. of transversal.
Yes.
So these are the omenta you take. And if you talk of D2 gastrectomy, what are the lymph node stations you take with this specimen?
Yes, for a distal D2 gastrectomy.
12.
12 you usually don't take. Is 1 to 11 is the standard description. At best, you can take 12A. 12 is taken as 12A, D and P. What does this stand for? A stands for 12 along the hepatic artery.
Hepatic artery. And that
P is along the duct. And P is along the posterior wall of the portal vein. So take even sometimes a 12A group you can take.
Because AGCC8 actually includes 12A as the nodal status. Previously, by the 7th, it was distal metastasis. Okay, so you have to take 12A. What are the other node stations that, what is the node station that there's a risk that might have to be left if you're doing a versus a total gastrectomy, a distal D2 gastrectomy versus a total gastrectomy? What is the node station that you tend to leave in a patient where you're doing a distal D2 gastrectomy? Which node stations do you have to leave? What is the node station along the esophagus? One is what?
Sir, one is the lymph nodes along the right gastric nodes, sir. Right gastric.
Right gastric.
Right gastric.
The cardia.
The right cardia.
So what is two?
It's the left cardiac nodes.
So yeah. Can you take two if you're doing a subtotal?
Subtotal scenario.
So two is normally excluded. What else is excluded? What are you leaving behind as blood supply to the remnant stomach? What arterial supply to the stomach are you trying to leave behind?
Lymph gastric is always divided.
Is there a blood supply that comes from the spleen?
Splenic
artery. So what are the lymph nodes that around Rhine run along with the short gastrics?
What are the nodes along the greater curvature as a whole? These are four.
Four, yes. So you have to leave that part of the four which runs along the short gastrics. So these are the two sets of nodes which you would leave, as opposed to when you're doing a total gastrectomy, you would take these two out, isn't it? What are the usual complications of the surgery?
First,
Professor Shah, we can have 2-minute discussion on this.
Yes, 2 minutes on this and then audience, any feedback.
Yeah.
Sir, immediate complications like hemorrhage.
Mm-hmm. What else?
Sir, the anastomotic leak can be there.
What sort of anastomosis have you done for this particular patient?
Gastrojejunostomy with Roux and Y reconstruction.
With Roux and Y. Okay, fair enough. Okay. So what is the other complication that we are all worried about?
Early complications are this hemorrhage and anastomotic leak.
What is that leak called as here? Important is duodenal stump blowout.
That's a deadly complication, isn't it? What else?
Sir, metabolic complications can be there.
Okay, what else?
Anemia, vitamin B12, iron deficiency anemia, mm-hmm. or osteoporosis or osteomalacia.
Delayed complications, not immediate.
Not immediate complications.
Dumping syndrome, early complication. Dumping syndrome can be there.
Can you have a hernia associated with this particular operation?
Yes, sir. Internal hernia can.
Okay, internal hernias. One particular hernia has a name. Do you know the name of that particular hernia?
Yes.
Is there something called a Peterson's hernia? Yeah.
Peterson's.
Which when the herniation occurs in between the gap in the mesentery.
Mesentery, yes. So I think. So,
Yeah, we have gone through almost everything. Any feedback from Dr. Maiti? Like to add anything? Professor Maiti?
Professor Acharya, Anadi Acharya is there.
Very well presentation by Dr. Chandrasekhar and crossing the answers you have given to the very, very interesting questions by Professor Saha and Professor Debuksi was excellent. But one comment I want to make, yes. Have you presented, Chandrasekhar, the chief complaint in your slides? One slide should be on the chief complaint. Was it there?
Yes. Pain abdomen for 1 year and vomiting for 6 months. Okay.
So with your presentation, you have mentioned that there is extreme tenderness for which you fail to palpate do the deep palpation. But it is unusual for the case of gastric carcinoma. Remember, the pain in the gastric carcinoma is not so severe and usually the inflammatory signs are less, so that you will be not able to do the deep palpation. I think you should take note of it, that probably the deep palpation could be done in these cases, and everything is done, otherwise it is very good.
Actually, the teaching in DNB exam is, if the patient is crying in front of examiner, the candidate will fail.
another thing, as the examiner have repeatedly pointed, you have mentioned so many absence of so many signs or the associated feature, but the jaundice you have failed to mention in your summary of the case, in the history as well as in the summary of
at least all GI symptoms should be there. Yes, you're very right.
Jaundice is to be mentioned very carefully. During the dehydration, one of the sign of dehydration is the sign of rees. In the extreme sort of dehydration where there is very scanty urine because of loss of turgor in the skin, if you press the skin, there will be the formation of the ridge. Remember, the sign of ridge. And in your slides, sometimes you have started the line with the small letters. Otherwise, it should be always start with capital letters in your slides.
First sentence.
And another thing, if I ask you, Chandrasekhar, what are the delayed features of malignant gastric malignancy, which cases are diagnosed very late, and you should answer that also, because sometimes the clinical presentation, as you have mentioned, the pain, the vomiting, these are the symptoms. You are fortunate only if it is a pre-pyloric growth. Otherwise, if the malignant is in the fundus and the body, most of the time the presentation will be very late.
Very late, absolutely.
And you have mentioned the vomiting is non-projectile. Okay. If it is a gastric outlet obstruction, most of the time it will be in the form of projectile vomiting. But for the other malignant sites in the fundus and in the stomach body, it is usually non-projectile. And in your presentation, if you cannot palpate any lump, and if it is a significant pain which aggravates with food, your provisional diagnosis in this particular patient may be made as a gastric ulcer, rather than in your features, the features are more in favor of gastric malignancy. But in an elderly patient, we should always exclude the malignancy. Even if you could make a diagnosis here in this particular patient as a gastric ulcer, that could not be wrong. And in your case presentation, I like to mention, in this forum, when you present a case, don't start, "I am presenting a case of gastric carcinoma." At the beginning, you start your case, and examiner, and at the end, will come to the diagnosis. Don't start it as a case of gastric carcinoma at the beginning. Okay, this is my comment. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you. Dr. Acharya, any comment? Dr. Acharya, unmute. You have to unmute, Dr. Acharya.
No, thank you for very well for the discussion. And many of the things that I wanted to comment about has been mentioned by Dr. Professor Sukumar Maiti. So I don't have anything to say, except one comment that in Professor Debuksi initially had put a lot of space on clinical examination. I think that is very important these days. Most of our students, postgraduate MS as well as DNB students, just fail to do a proper clinical examination. That is very important. Also, not only for deciding about the what investigations to be done, also for management in general. So I think that is a good point in this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
In fact, in the exam, there are separate marks being earmarked for
clinical examination.
Yes,
discussion.
Absolutely.
Because it's not only discussion, because most of the previous students are very converted to recent advances.
Yes.
So
yes.
You should start with the clinical examination and then go on to the investigation and little about the disease process. So we have a very nice discussion. Thank you so much. We have gone 10 minutes extra.
Thank you.
Okay.
Makun.
Yes.
I think from this discussion, it is clear that these students do not really have proper idea about the basic principles of management of a GI tract malignancy. So if you can arrange a short discussion on that particular topic in some of the sessions, I think that will be in general very helpful to the...
Okay. Anuja, we will have some faculty lectures. I am planning for some faculty lectures once in a month. Where we address all these issues.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Anuja. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, Makun. Thank you.